Boom.
I just, everybody else walked on that way, and I just thought it'd be a bit of a break for you. Must be a very grueling day for you, absorbing all this information and responding. Well, look, it's a great honour, really, to be part of a, well, you can't see it now, but TEDx talk. And my, I don't know, did they put up, I don't think they put up the title of my talk. I had two titles. One was called Peekaboo and Catch CO2, and the other one was called The Last Tim Tam. Which would you prefer? All right. What we're going to do in the time that I have, I'm going to talk to you about where we've come from, and I'm also going to speculate about where we're going. The lovers, the dream. Now, the dreamer part of it really for me has now become a nightmare, and I'm going to try as best I can to scare you shitless in the next 18 minutes. So let's go back in time. Let's go back to the Big Bang. We've heard a little bit about it all day already today, but there's the Big Bang, the beginning of universe. And from my point of view, this is where the trouble started. If it hadn't have been for that, I don't think we'd be where we are. Now, nobody knows why that happened. Some people think it was the agency of a deity that caused that to happen. And other people think it happened because. And they're the two choices, okay? I'll leave them entirely up to you. So with the Big Bang, space, matter and time were created. And so we roll along through time about 8.5 billion years, 8.5 billion years, and this is where the Earth formed. Now, it wasn't blue to begin with. It was a molten, boiling, broiling mass of stuff. Sorry if I get too technical. Okay, but a ball of stuff. Now, it doesn't look like that anymore. It's not the blue delight that we know. We have managed to turn it into something vaguely approaching that and a little bit of red for Iraq. Okay, so things are happening. We've really buggered up the Earth. But for the beginning, it was great. You know, it went on and the galaxies and things are happening and we're evolving. And then about, I don't know, a billion years after everything started, water came to the planet. And with water came life. And that created David Attenborough. So already you can see that things are improving, progress. It's about progress. So life goes on, we have a mass extinction, life comes out, another mass extinction. Around here, the fundamentals of coal were laid down. Over here, oil was begun over here. And then we go on to about 12,000 years ago, and this is where civilization began. Now, civilization began, and I'll just very quickly do this for you. Here's the Earth. Norway and Sweden, Denmark there, you got France, Spain, Germany, Italy, and we won't even worry about Africa, the Red Sea, the Gulf, India, the Malay Peninsula, China, Hong Kong, excitement, North and South Korea, kaboom, 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 Bering Straits, West Coast America, South America down there, a few islands here, an island there, a couple of islands there, somewhere down here, there's a big island, and of course we're down over here, and I'll put Tasmania there. Now, you'll understand why I've done that later on. So this is the world that we know. But it hasn't always looked like this. We live on these tectonic plates that are moving. They move about the rate your fingernails grow. India is pushing into the vast land mass above us and forcing up the Himalayas. I read in 2012 that New Zealand moved 6 centimetres closer to Australia. They're coming to get us. I rang Air New Zealand. I said, does that mean the flights are cheaper? And they said, feck off, because they can't say the letter U. So this is the world that we've inherited. And with the beginning of civilization 12,000 years ago, based on agriculture, here in what is very sadly now Iraq, civilization began in Iraq. It wasn't Iraq at the time, and there's a terrible feeling that it may well end in Iraq. We're back in there, and some of you are old, and I look out and some of you are really old, and a couple of you are just on the happy side of deceased, and I'm glad that you could make this day today. The first time we did it, We've done it a lot, but certainly the last time with John Howard, and this is John Howard here at full scale, and I've been doing a show talking about John Howard, and I've had a lot of young people who say, well, who is he? So I have to explain, and then they leave in tears. So the first time we went in because of 9/11, but of course that had nothing to do with it. And then it was weapons of mass destruction, which we never ever found. Now this is what makes me worry about the group intelligence of the United States. Okay, 40 years ago they staged the landing on the moon. Here they face international embarrassment because they couldn't find weapons of mass destruction. Now, the United States has got more weapons of mass destruction than all the other countries on the in the world combined. They have enough weapons of mass destruction to destroy all life on Earth 17 times over. And I'm here to tell you, you only need to do it once. So clearly, they have weapons of mass destruction surplus to needs. And if you're embarrassed that they haven't got any, why not just get a little file of anthrax? You know, you've got plenty, just get one. Get the wrapper off an Egyptian date packet that's got lots of Arabic on it and wrap it around that and just sort of kick it over the... Whoop, there it goes, whoop. See, I told you they were there, I told... But they can't even think to do that. So civilization began here 12,000 years ago. Then we had the pyramids and the Greeks and the Romans and the Middle Ages and then the greatest age, the age of the Enlightenment. I'm sorry, that says enlightenment, okay? The age of enlightenment. And this is where the superstition and ignorance of the past were washed away by rational thought, logic, and the science, the beginning of science as we know it today. And of course, they were also the people in France who invented the guillotine, one of the really great inventions of all time. And we'll come back to the guillotine when we talk about how we change the future. After that, science and technology hand in hand walked us towards the Industrial Revolution. And up until the Industrial Revolution, there were never more than 280 parts per million of CO2 in the atmosphere. It went below that, but hardly ever went above it. For 800,000, possibly some millions of years, that's the maximum. Today, it is 400 parts per million. Today. Now, if you put 200 over 4 and you multiply by 100 over 1 to get and you divide by 2 and 100, it equals a percentage, okay? It equals a percentage, all right? So it's a problem. We are at 400 parts per million. And 100 years ago, the first warnings about carbon in the atmosphere. A Swedish Nobel Prize winner said that if we doubled CO2, we'll raise the temperature of the planet beyond the bearing of life as we know it today. So more warnings, more warnings, more warnings, more warnings, more warnings, more warnings, and then all of a sudden, 1957, Tony Abbott was born. Now, I don't know if you remember, some of you would have seen the movie, it's called The Omen. And and he became Prime Minister, and a remarkable thing happened. The arrow of time began reversing. We got rid of the carbon tax. We got rid of the climate commission. We're going to get rid of clean energy. We're going back. He's the man who had the idea of introducing knights and dames. That's the only idea he's ever had, knights and dames. We're heading back to the medieval period. Now we've got a knight and we've got a dame. But unfortunately, they're not a breeding pair. So we're not going to have any more of them. But we're going back in time. And all the advances that have been made to try and get us to understand the challenges of carbon in our system, it's gone. We are going to hell in a handbasket. Now, hand up those people who woke up this morning and thought, my day won't be complete without a graph. Yep, okay. Here's the graph. You might recognise it. There it is. Now, I've got to hurry. I've only got a minute left. But there's the graph. Do you know what it's called? It's a bell curve graph, named after Alexander Graham Curve. Okay? This is the curve of oil. 1857, mechanical drilling for oil. Invention of the motor car, needed something to drive on, asphalt. Then we got aeroplanes, World War II, the most industrialised, oil-hungry war in history. Then the two-stroke motor blower, and then the leaf blower. And now we've gone over for the peak of oil. And the oil is running out. And what people don't understand is the oil is running out. You can tell people that the oil is running out, but what people don't understand is the oil is running out. And that's our only hope. That is our only hope. People talk all the time about 2 degrees, 2 degrees, got to stop at 2 degrees. 400 parts per million means we never stop at 2 degrees. We're going to go to 3 and 4, perhaps as early as 2040, 2050. We're going to create a planet that is so inhospitable to mammalian life. And you were mammals, just to prove it, two fingers in the air, quickly, I'm running out of time. On the count of three, I want you to point at your nipples. One, two, three. Point, point, point. We are mammals, okay? We cannot live in a 4 degree warmer world. That's the challenge. And the only answer now is not politics, not democracy. Rupert Murdoch owns our democracy. The answers lie somewhere in this ancient invention. So look, I'm well out of time. I thank you very, very much for your time today. And I'll leave you with that.
Rod, get back. Rod. Rod, Rod, Rod.
Oh, hang on.
Come back, please. Take your applause.
I've actually got 3 minutes. Hey. Okay. Well, look, it turns out that I've got 3 minutes left. I tried to compress the whole of human history. All right, look, we'll just use that 3 minutes to really attack the core of what we're going into. We live in a world of denial. All of that science that's piled up and piled up and piled up to warn us to stop doing what we're doing, is nothing's had any impact. And at the heart of it are the right-wing think tanks. Right-wing think tanks. Pick the word that's out of place. Okay, the right-wing think tank. In the United States, they've got the Cato Institute, they've got the Heartland Institute. In Australia, we've got the IPA, the Institute of Public Affairs. This is the dark heart of neoliberal free market deregulation and cowboy economics that's going to thrive under Abbott. And these people are evil. That's not a word you use lightly, but they are driving us into the chasm that is the future of climate change and the collapse of industrial society. And they are evil. Look, I is the sixth letter of the alphabet. P is the ninth letter of the alphabet, which is a six upside down. And you never have more than, A is for apples, and you never have more than six apples. So there you see it. 666, the number of the beast. Now, who are these people? Who are these people? They're a shadowy organisation of lies and propaganda and no regard for truth. Funded by Gina Rhino. I don't know. Nobody knows. Clive Palmer here in Queensland. You should be ashamed of yourself. Clive, all of them are in there, okay? And they're pumping money into these places, and out it pours through the Murdoch press. Now, this is the world. The world is a great big bubble. It's the Murdoch bubble, and it's actually Murdoch's ass. And everybody is up it, okay? And what's really wonderful is it's a babushka world of being up arses, because Andrew Bolt's up Gina Reinhart's ass. She's up his ass. Damn, just all over the place. So look, the challenges are formidable. The dream has turned into a nightmare. We are extraordinary. Australians are extraordinary people. Okay, we're inventive people. Because of our colonial roots and our distance from Europe, we had to adapt and be inventive. We're the people who invented the stubby. 12,000 years, people of drinking beer, but it was up to us to invent a handy glass portable container for your alcohol. And within seconds of picking up the stubby, we went, oh shit, that's cold, and we invented the stubby holder. We are the people who invented wine in a box, so you could look like an executive on the way to swimming in your own vomit. We're the people. We are the people that invented the screw top for wine so you could get at it quicker. That's why we don't have a space program. We're too busy too busy inventing better ways of getting at alcohol. So the challenge that we face today is a challenge that says we have to be carbon neutral within 5 years. 5 years to decarbonise the world. It isn't going to happen. We will burn every drop of oil. We will burn every lump of coal to keep going this fantasy principle of growth at all costs. And so the challenge for you as individuals, democracy will not respond in time. There's no democratic process in the world that will reduce Australia's emission by 80% by 2018. There is no democracy that will allow that. We're going backwards. We're going backwards. We will go so far back. We will go through a mass extinction. We'll go back and back and back right to the beginning. We'll de-evolve into single-celled organisms. And God, or because, will say, try again, and we'll have another crack at it. And the great, 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 great grandson of Tony Abbott will be Prime Minister then, and back we go again, and back we go. So that's the future. Do something about it, will you? I'm busy. Thank you very much. Good afternoon.
Thank you.